What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Today's video targets associative arrays, or what you may know as hash tables, maps, or even dictionaries. So a map in the Java world is an abstract data type, composed of a collection of key-value pairs, where each key appears only once in the collection and has a value associated with it. The value can be anything from an integer to a string or a list or even another map. Most of the time they are implemented as hash tables with the help of arrays, which we will discuss in a bit. And in some other cases, they are implemented using binary or ternary trees, which we will discuss in future videos. The aim of maps is to make most operations reach O of 1 time complexity. Let's focus on the get operation for now. How are we going to retrieve an item in an O of 1 time complexity? The only case we know about is the fetch by index. Given an index, we can retrieve the value stored inside this specific location in the array. Well, here our values are indeed stored inside an array, so that's not a problem. However, in this case, we do not have indices. We just said that we have keys, and each key has a value, and for each given key, we want to retrieve the value associated with it. How will we do that? If our keys were limited to integers only, you could say that we can use this key as the index in a given array, and then we will be able to fetch the values by index or by key in this case. But the thing is, our key can be a string or any other custom-made object, and if that is the case, how are we going to retrieve its corresponding value stored inside the map? Well, here comes hashing. Hashing is at the center of maps and hash tables. What hashing does is it tries to associate each given key with an index. And at this index, we go ahead and store our value. When later on we want to retrieve this value by key, we hash again the given key to retrieve the same index value. And using this index, we go ahead and retrieve the element stored in an O of 1 time complexity. Let's take this set of n string keys, for example, where n equals 3, and try to insert them alongside their corresponding values in this array, where we can put at maximum m elements, m being 6 in this case. We are going to do this using the hashing function you can see in front of you. It is a pretty simple one. All it does is return the length of the string we passed to it. So let's say that the first string or key we have is geek. Its corresponding hash will be 4. Easy, right? So the first key will be mapped to index 4, the second one to index 5, and the third to index 2. You see, the results of this function will always lead to the same index, because the length of our keys is never going to change unless the whole key changes, which means we are inserting a new key value pair. Now that our values are stored, if we want to retrieve the value corresponding to our second key, for example, we will be able to retrieve it by index, and that is the beauty of it. In this case, we can also calculate what we call the load factor, which is n over m, n being the number of entries or keys, and m being the number of buckets available or total slots our array can store, as we already mentioned. When this factor is equal to 0, our table is empty, and when this factor is 1, the array is full. But why am I telling you about this factor? Well, it is because of resizing. At the end, all we have is an array, and this array can become full at any time. This factor will help us determine whether we need to resize our array, like dynamically, as we saw in previous videos, or not. In Java maps, resizing is done at 0.75, or 75%, and in Python at 2/3, or 66%. However, nothing is ideal, and so isn't our hashing function. What I mean by this is, let's suppose we have a fourth key, like. Our current hashing function, which returns the length of the given string, will return a 4 for us. But guess what? We already have an item sitting at index 4, and if we go ahead and store this new value, the old value will forever be lost. The hashing function we wrote just mapped two different keys to the same index. But the deal at the beginning was, if we decided to retrieve a value by key, when hashing this key, the index we are going to map to is guaranteed to be unique. And that is not what we are witnessing now, right? Well, this is called a collision, and collisions can be resolved using chaining or open addressing. Let's further discuss these two techniques. In case of chaining, if our keys were mapped to the same index, what we do is store both these values in the same slot of the array, but as a linked list, hence the name chaining. We will chain them one after the other. So, in our previous example, the value having like for key will be inserted next to the value having geek for key in the linked list sitting at index 4. Now, if we replace our hashing function with this one, which is definitely the worst hashing function you can come up with, all our values will be mapped to the same slot in the array, as it always returns the same index regardless of the key you are passing to it. In this case, we will only have one linked list holding all the values of all our keys. When we need to retrieve a specific value, we will have to go through all the items in the linked list and perform a search by value. We just transformed our potential O of 1 complexity into an O of n time complexity. In such rare cases, we have what we call a worst case scenario. This stresses the importance of our hashing function, and the fact that the more injective this function is, the better. We just established that chaining may reach an O of n worst case time complexity, and because of this, the second technique or method we are now going to discuss is more adopted. This collision resolution method goes by open addressing. Open addressing resolves a hash collision with probing, or in other terms, it searches for another empty or available slot in the array to store our value in. Some of the well-known probe sequences include linear probing, in which we travel between probes or array slots in a linear way in search of other empty slots. The index difference in which we search is fixed, hence the linear term, and is often set to 1. In our previous example, the key like, which was mapped to the same slot as geek, will be mapped again, using a plus 1 probe, to index 5. But in our case, index 5 is also occupied, so it will be remapped to the next available index, which is 0, because of the modulo operator we are using, and the value having like as key will sit there. The next sequence is the quadratic probing. In this sequence, the interval between probes increases quadratically, and in this case, we take the original hash index found and add successive values of an arbitrary quadratic polynomial until an open slot is found. In our example, the 1 squared polynomial will lead to an index 5, which is taken, and 2 squared will result in index 2, also occupied. However, adding the 3 to the power 2 polynomial will help us find a new index, which is 1 in this example. The last probe sequence you are going to cover, and basically the most generic one, is double hashing. Here we hash again the result using another hash function to find another empty slot. Every other case is a specific case of the double hashing, because after all, what you are doing is passing the results to another function, whether linear, quadratic, or any other kind of function, and try to come up with a new index for the key that collided with the one we already stored in our array. In this example, the second hash function we are using is basically the initial function we used, modulo m. We are also multiplying the result with every collision, because if we don't do that, we will keep looping over the same number. In our example, we will need to hash the key twice before retrieving an empty slot, and this hash function will result in an index 0 where our value will be stored. Now, if you want to have a deeper understanding of maps and want to know how they are actually implemented and how collisions are resolved using chaining or open addressing, stay tuned as a maps implementation video is being prepared and will soon be uploaded. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I'll see you in the next one.